This is the introduction to the tool design course. So first thing, the types of tools that we're talking about, these are not really hand tools like you might be thinking, like hammers and screwdrivers, pliers, things like that. We are talking about tooling, essentially cutting tools, press tooling, mold tooling, things like that. All right, so the goal of doing tool design, the reason that you would do tool design, really at its core, is to reduce cost. All right, so you're trying to reduce the overall cost to manufacture a product. Now, sometimes that involves increasing the production rate, not always necessarily. So you might be working on a production line that might produce 1,000 widgets in a shift. And if you take one sub-process out of that and you make it faster, you might improve things. You might not, though. You're only improving things if that is the slowest part of that process. Everything really should be balanced. A really good book, if you're not familiar with it, why you might not want to just increase production rate arbitrarily within a certain part of the larger process is to read the Goal by Goldblatt. There you go. So I'll just plug his book right here. It's pretty much a classic, kind of forms the foundation of theory of constraints, but a real good example of that. All right. So a real good reason why you only sometimes want to increase the production rate. It's not always a given, I'll say. Typically, you'll want to maintain or even improve the quality. Part of thinking about tool design is to take some of the cost out of the tooling. All right, so what you want is cost-effective tooling, not necessarily cheap tools. Anybody that's bought a cheap hand tool or something knows that that's not always the easiest way to reduce cost. In fact, sometimes really cheap tooling will increase cost. So what this is about is finding sort of that sweet spot, okay, where you have cost-effective tooling, tooling that gets the job done but doesn't cost an arm and a leg to produce, okay? A real easy trap for a young designer or engineer to fall into is the idea that they'll design something and then they'll get a little pushback from management about how expensive their design is, okay? There can be a lot of reasons for that. One thing to always consider is what the overall goal of designing that thing is for. Okay, you're trying to reduce the overall cost, and if a tool is not cost effective, if it's just unnecessarily expensive, then that is that's going to be trouble. Okay, that's tooling is by its nature pretty expensive stuff. Okay. And I have heard lots of usually young engineers talk about how management just doesn't like, they don't want to make quality things, okay? They're not willing to spend the money on this tool that I've designed. And there's a really good reason for that, okay? So always consider cost and look for sort of the low-hanging fruit where you can take cost out and not affect anything, okay? So always keep that in mind. And of course, tools need to be safe and they need to be easy to use. So there are some areas of knowledge that we'll talk about. We will review some areas. You should already have a background in these areas, okay? Computer-aided design and engineering drawing in general. Your statics and strengths of material class will be brought to bear a little bit in this class. Also, you should be familiar with manufacturing processes. If you're in my class, you should have already had two manufacturing processes courses, processes one and processes two. So that's kind of the background. We will talk about cutting tools, tool holders. I'll just tell you, we're not going to talk so much about cutting fluids in this class. We talk about that in processes one. But we will sort of talk about, you know, why, what the coolant's doing, how to deal with coolant, because that can be an issue. Well, you should also know a little bit about machine tools. We'll talk a little bit more about those. We'll talk a little bit more about presses in particular, maybe a little bit more about injection molding machines, things like that. We will talk about jig and fixture design and work holding concepts. We'll talk about gauging and measuring instruments, a really big deal in this class. We will also talk about sheet metal die design and a little bit about die design for forging and upsetting and cold finishing, cold working, extrusion. We will talk about molds for plastics manufacturing, in particular injection mold design. And we will also talk about fixture design, you know, for welding, welding fixtures and for assembly fixtures. All right, so this is a design course, and so designing is a process, and you should not just design without thinking about it. You should go through a process and be systematic about your design. And I will say, it's not on this slide, but take the time to document your thought process, because you may have heard a very famous saying out there, remember, you will forget. And that is really true in design examples. Okay, it's amazing the things that I've forgotten. All right, that's and you need to be able to communicate how you arrived at the decisions that you made. Okay, because when you design, you make a series of decisions, and you need to know which decisions you are equipped to make and which decisions you need to get other input. Little hint, get lots of input. All right, so the first part is the statement of the problem. You need to know what the problem is that you're trying to solve. And you need to understand the scope of what the problem is. Okay, in tool design, a lot of times there is a tendency to want to go out and change the product. Okay, and really, truth be told, if somebody's designing product, if you were the person designing product and you have stumbled on this lecture, always, always get input from the people that are going to be designing the tooling. Okay, so if you're fortunate enough to get access to the design before it's been finalized as a tooling engineer, then that's a first-class situation. That's what you want. However, sometimes in the problems that you solve through tooling, changing the product is off limits. It may already have gone through testing and evaluation, and what they want is to produce this particular product. All right, so sometimes the scope is more narrow than others, okay? But really, it is a big deal to get input from tool designers as you're doing product design. If you're making any kind of assumptions, and you will find yourself having to make assumptions, make sure that you state those assumptions and that the people who have the stakeholders, basically, the people who have skin in the game, that those people understand what those assumptions are. Okay, so be upfront about any assumptions as you find yourself, and you will, as you find yourself needing to make those assumptions. Okay, so always chase those down. Don't leave them as loose ends. And there is a point at which you kind of have, you know, you have to leave off and say, yeah, this is an assumption that I'm stating, and you have to design within the constraints of that assumption. For instance, you might say, you know, this product is going to be used in the commercial market. Okay, so maybe it's made for commercial resellers, and it's not going to find its way into retail. All right, things like that. All right, so also the next sort of step in this process is to analyze the requirements. All right, understand what the job is that this thing needs to do. What are the constraints? Are there going to be constraints for the tolerance? Well, yes, they're going to be. Okay, so every product has a tolerance, and that's going to be something you're going to need to know about. All right, what kind of environment is the tool going to be used in? Now, when you think about environment and design, normally you're thinking about things like salt spray exposure and sunlight exposure, and those would apply. You know, you might be in a very corrosive environment, something like that. And it could also deal with the situation that the workers that are going to be using your tool have. Do they have adequate lighting? Are there lifting mechanisms nearby that can enable them to move the tooling with lifting eyes? Or are you going to need to design smaller, lightweight tooling that can be handled manually? All right, and then you reach this point where you start to develop initial ideas. All right, so you're taking information from other people. In particular, get out on the assembly line or wherever it is that that the tool is going to be used. Talk to the people that use the tools that that you're designing. Okay, get input from the end users. Get input from different sources. If you're not going to be the person actually constructing and making the tool, talk to the people who will, and have an appreciation for how hard it is to achieve certain tolerances and things like that. So seek information. Get online, see what other people are doing, how other people are solving that problem. All right, there is no shame in that. All right, so see what's currently being implemented and how other people are solving that problem. Get lots of ideas, okay, especially at first. Nothing's really off the wall at first. Things do kind of, you know, there are ideas that are crazy, and they should be, you know, evaluated, but, you know, you want an idea that's going to work. All right, and then you start to sift through and figure out which of these designs is, you know, actually the most feasible and probably the most cost-effective, and, you know, really what is the best solution, and then begin to develop and finalize ideas of that design. All the time getting input as often as you as is practical. Okay, so really get input from a lot of people, and sometimes you have to be careful with that. You have to be a little diplomatic about it, because somebody on the line might suggest something about the tooling, and it might be something that's feasible, and it might be a dumb or a dangerous idea, and you need to be careful sort of how you handle that politically. So you do want to get information. You want to show people that you appreciate their input, but if somebody does give you input and you don't listen to it, you know, kind of tie that loose end up. It's a good idea. All right, then you finalize it, and there is a saying here that done is better than perfect. Okay, but you do want it to be right. For goodness sakes, it needs to be right. But yeah, don't seek the perfect solution. Sometimes that's, you know, you can get a really, really good solution, but it's not like a math problem where there's a right answer at the end. Okay, you can always keep on designing. You can keep on making changes, but at some point, you've got to get a good design that works, and get it moved forward and get the thing implemented. Okay, otherwise you're just you know, in tooling, and we'll talk about this a little bit later. But if you're designing tooling, or if you're doing product design, you are overhead, and you are pushing out any time that you waste. You're pushing out the start date of when you can start rolling out product. All right, so there is going to be a time constraint if you're working in the area of tool design. All right, and then of course after you finalize this design, you get it implemented. Sometimes that involves working in tooling and doing some pre-production evaluation of the tooling and making sure that it's working, and maybe polishing some surfaces and tweaking your actual design as it's, you know, when you have hard tooling in your hand. And then after it's been implemented and it's making parts or whatever it's doing, do this last step and evaluate, follow up. Okay, if something's wrong, people are going to probably follow up. You know, if something's bad wrong, you're probably going to be followed up with automatically. But even if not, go out, see how people are using the tool that you designed, and get some input. All right, this is just unpacking that little bit about requirements. So up here we talked a little bit about the analysis of requirements and some of the constraints. Understand, you know, what are the functions? What does this tool have to do? What is sort of the level of precision? We'll talk a little bit more about that later. I talked a little bit about what the environment is. It might be going to a plant in another country, and you might have labels and things written on that tool with instructions, and that might not be the language that the people that are using it are going to be familiar with. So understand everything about the environment where it's going to be implemented. All right, cost, way down here in the middle. Really, this is number one. Okay, so tooling by its nature is expensive, and I guess you probably get a little bit more leeway with tooling because it is so darned expensive, and because generally the cost is spread out across sometimes hundreds and sometimes thousands or even millions of units. And we'll talk about that in just a minute. But where you can, you know, don't make costs. Take cost out where you can. There's a lot of places where you can get remove cost for free and not affect the quality or the usability of the tooling at all, the function. Lead time is going to be an issue. Getting something made with a wire EDM or not a wire EDM necessarily, but you know, wire EDM takes some time. Plunge EDM takes some time because you have to machine an electrode. You might have to get work elements of your design may have to come from different suppliers who all have other customers as well. So pay attention to that. And like I said, remember that sort of phenomenon that tool design is overhead, and you will find yourself being asked for updates on when that tool is going to be ready, because if that tool's not right, the tool's not ready, then you're pushing out production, and you might have many, many people who are being paid waiting for that production to start, because you don't start making money on that product until the product has paid for the tooling, and that doesn't get paid for until people start buying lots and lots of that product. So there is always, always going to be that time constraint. Safety, also an issue. You do want to make sure that your whatever your tooling is, that it conforms to OSHA guidelines or whatever the other safety guidelines might be in place. You want to make sure that there aren't sharp edges, that there are not pinch points, in-running nips and things like that, and we'll talk a little bit more about that later. Also, this is a pretty big one about if you're designing tooling. Look for places where you can standardize. Now, sometimes this may go beyond the scope of what you're designing, but I've worked at a place for a while, and we did some cold forming tooling, and this press that we used was really a pain in the butt to set up. You had to use a spanner wrench on it, and it had a really fine thread, and if you had to move this press ram back or forth maybe an inch, it would take a good 20 or 30 minutes to get that ram adjusted. And we realized collectively sort of that if we were to standardize on our tool links on the base, basically the shank end, that we could save an awful lot of setup time. And it might be that we put a little bit of extra money into tool steel to make maybe the tool an inch longer than it needed to be, but that got paid for really quickly when we realized that the setup cost could be dramatically decreased by standardizing things like shank links. All right. And then also the working life. Is this tool that you're designing, does it need to produce 100 units, or does it need to produce a million units, for 5 years, a million units a shift, something like that? So you want to, you know, this is part of being informed about the design, about the requirements. All right, sort of the economics of design, which really does drive tool design a lot more than you may have expected. But that's why you're designing the tooling, is to make money on this part. All right, always think lean. Where you can combine operations or eliminate additional setups maybe you can design this thing to be made once you put it into a vise and you do all your cuts on one side rather than having to flip it over and do other cuts on the back side. Things like that, where you can eliminate operations or move them all to one side of the part, stuff like that. All right, let's start to break down some of these process cost comparisons. All right, so first of all is the total unit cost. Okay, so this one is when you get that stunned look from a customer when they wanted 5 or 6 injection molded little parts and they expected to pay, you know, $1 or $2 for them, and you tell them, oh no, those are going to cost $165 each. Okay, they might be used to going to the dollar store and buying a plastic part, and they might have a low production run project, and they want to make a very small number of something that requires a very expensive piece of tooling to make, and they're sometimes very, very shocked about that. All right, so this is a calculation that you would probably be able to arrive at, even if I hadn't given it to you. Okay, it's pretty intuitive. It's the cost that's bound up in each little unit. So let's say that this is the amount, you know, the material cost, say. So it costs maybe $3 in plastic for each of these. So that's the unit cost, which is going to, you know, be a nice linear relationship with the number of units that you make. So you just multiply how much each unit costs by the number of units that you're going to make. So if they cost, if there's $3 worth of plastic bound up in these, and you make 5 of them, then you got $15 in plastic bound up. All right, and it's not necessarily material cost, but it's really the fixed cost for each of those individual units. Then you add to that the tooling cost. All right, so the tooling cost is going to be the big giant chunk in here, and you divide that by the number of units that you're going to make. Okay, so look at a real short run injection molding project, for example. Don't use this picture, but sort of think about it. Each unit, we got $3 in the plastic, say. Maybe it's like PEEK or some kind of expensive plastic. We're making 5 units total, so we got $15 worth of plastic. Add to that the $810 for the injection mold, which, by the way, this is not an $800 mold. Much more expensive than that. But let's say we've got $800 in the tooling. Then we divide by the number of units that we're making again, and we learn that each one of these little units down here is going to cost us $165. So sometimes that's a shocker to people, and they don't understand the fact that tooling is very expensive. All right. Another really, really useful formula is this break-even point. Let me back up one more time, just back here to the total unit cost. These are really good to see on senior projects. Okay, so total unit cost, something that I'd like to see calculated on pretty much any senior project. The break-even point. This comes up constantly. You'll be able to see this all over the place once you start looking for it, okay? And that is, let's say you got 2 different ways of making a widget, okay? You got method Y and method Z. There's a tooling cost associated with each of those. One of them has a low-cost tooling, one of them has more expensive cost tooling. And as you might expect, and this is typically the case, the one with the more expensive tooling has got a lower unit process cost. Okay, it might take less time to make it, less man hours to make the part. With the lower cost tooling, it might be more expensive. So one of the classic comparisons would be like injection molding. Okay, so let's just say that we've got 2 different ways of making a plastic part. Let's go first of all with a machined part. It's the cost that's bound up in each little unit. So let's say that this is the amount, you know, the material cost, say. So it costs maybe $3 in plastic for each of these. So that's the unit cost, which is going to, you know, be a nice linear relationship with the number of units that you make. So you just multiply how much each unit costs by the number of units that you're going to make. So if they cost, if there's $3 worth of plastic bound up in these and you make five of them, then you got $15 in plastic bound up. All right. And it's not necessarily material cost, but it's really the fixed cost for each of those individual units. Then you add to that the tooling cost. All right. So the tooling cost is going to be the big giant chunk in here. And you divide that by the number of units that you're going to make. Okay, so look at a real short run injection molding project, for example. Don't use this picture, but sort of think about it. Each unit, we got $3 in the plastic, say. Maybe it's like PEEK or some kind of expensive plastic. We're making 5 units total. So we got $15 worth of plastic. Add to that the $810 for the injection mold, which, by the way, this is not an $800 mold. Much more expensive than that. But let's say we've got $800 in the tooling. Then we divide by the number of units that we're making again. And we learn that each one of these little units down here is going to cost us $165. So sometimes that's a shocker to people, and they don't understand the fact that tooling is very expensive. All right, another really, really useful formula is this break-even point. Let me back up one more time, just back here to the total unit cost. These are really good to see on senior projects. Okay, so total unit cost, something that I'd like to see calculated on pretty much any senior project. The break-even point. This comes up constantly. You'll be able to see this all over the place once you start looking for it, okay? And that is, let's say you got two different ways of making a widget, okay? You got method Y and method Z. There's a tooling cost associated with each of those. One of them has a low-cost tooling, one of them has more expensive cost tooling. And as you might expect, and this is typically the case, the one with the more expensive tooling has got a lower unit process cost. Okay, it might take less time to make it, less man hours to make the part. With the lower cost tooling, it might be more expensive. So one of the classic comparisons would be like injection molding. Okay, so let's just say that we've got two different ways of making a plastic part. Let's go first of all with a machined part. Okay, so let's say that we're going to machine this part. So there are, like we saw before, there are two sort of components to the machined, to the cost in machining these. Number one is the tooling cost. So maybe we have to make a little soft jaw or something to machine these parts. So there's a very small amount of money involved in the actual tooling, but it's slow and it takes a lot of time. So each unit that we make has a significant cost penalty because it takes so darn long to make each of those widgets. Well, if we have an injection molding process, then yeah, we're going to pay a lot more for the tooling up front. But if we keep making parts, you see, each part that we make is much easier and cheaper and faster to make. And this is only showing cheaper, obviously. But it's much faster and cheaper to make than the machining method. Okay, well, if the question is, well, let's say we're making 5 parts. 5 parts sounds like a very small number of parts. Which method do we make? Well, obviously, probably, we're going to be machining those parts. Well, what about 100 parts? 1,000 parts? 10,000 parts? And what the question is, well, where does it make more sense to spend the money on the injection molding tooling rather than to just go with machining? And the answer is right here on this diagram, and that is the place where those two costs meet each other. Okay, so right here at this number of units, this is the place where we would make the decision. On this side, the better decision is to injection mold, and on this side, the better decision is to to machine the part, okay? And that's what this equation is doing for us, okay? It's comparing the two methods. We have the tooling cost and the unit process cost for each one, and this N sub B, when you calculate this, that will tell you the number of units at the break-even point. All right, now this is the one of the sort of classical economic lot size calculations, and I would like you to get a spreadsheet that will calculate this, but in terms of talking about this, I'd rather talk about it using this diagram right here, okay? Now, you may have heard it said that really the ideal lot size, and of course lot size is the number of parts that you're going to make in a particular setup. So let's say we set up our injection mold and we start making parts. When does it make the most sense to, you know, what's the best economic lot size? How many parts should we make in one setup? And you may have heard it said that the ideal, which is different than the economic size, the ideal size is 1. All right, and here's what they're getting at. The thing that's making us want to make a larger lot size is the setup cost. Okay, so when you see this, as you get lower and lower, smaller and smaller lot sizes, the setup cost doesn't get divided by all of those little pieces. You wind up paying a lot of money to set up the machine, and that means that you're going to want to make larger lots, okay? So really, the moral of this story is, it is ideal to lower this setup cost. And you'll see all kinds of lean books talking about this, lean concepts, talking about striving to a lot size of 1, where what you want to be able to do ideally, see the storage cost and the direct cost, not much you're gonna do with direct cost, but your storage cost, if you drive in this direction, let's just take a setup out of the equation. If setup didn't exist, then you can see pretty clearly that the economic lot size down here is 1. Okay, so you just have the direct cost. What you want, ideally, is a customer places an order, and that afternoon, you ship that part the same day. Okay, you don't make thousands of them and keep them in storage because you may have heard in another class this concept of muda and the fact that you're tying, when you do that, you see you've tied up all that money in storage, you've tied up all that money in the raw materials and in the finished goods, and it could be exposed to damage, and it's taking a risk, and it's tying up funds, okay? So what you want to do is, as best as possible, to understand this economic lot size, understand that setup is kind of the enemy. And there's a lot of concepts out there like SMED, single minute exchange of dies, that you should really start to be familiar with, because the more you can take out setup cost, then the lower you can reduce your lot size more and more, and you can get a more agile system in place. All right, so some of the other things that we're going to talk about in this class will be cutting tool design, and we'll look at some of that. You will design a cutting tool. When we do this class in person, then we make a cutting tool, make a little engraving tool, which is not in that picture there. Some other tooling that we'll look at designing is press tooling. So kind of get familiar with what presses are, progressive dies and transfer presses and things like that. We'll talk about those kinds of things. This is a pretty nice little video of a little hydraulic press. All right, so that's some more tooling there. There are other types of tooling, like these are tube informing videos. There are lots and lots of videos on tooling out there. But this is some tooling that I used to work with back in the day. So that's why they are in your slides. We'll also look at molds and designing injection molds. This is an extraordinarily simple injection mold. This is kind of like the ones that if you took the 4476 computer-aided manufacturing class, you will have designed and possibly made a mold like this one. That one's actually from somebody's senior project. They did, these are actually, they're two components, and this made a little magnetic flashlight that had a little USB charging port in there. This was just the housing for that. It's kind of a nice little project. We'll also talk about work holding and inspection tools. Also talk about toolmakers' tools somewhat. Tool making is a pretty, pretty exact and pretty precise undertaking. It's and we'll look at some of that in just a little bit. But a lot of inspection for like GD&T or inspection on computer coordinate measuring machines, CMMs. There's a lot of fixturing that goes into those things sometimes. We'll look at tooling drawings. Make sure that you know what goes into a good engineering drawing. All right, I just cannot stress the fact that how important it is to be able to put together a clear, readable engineering drawing that conforms to standards, in particular ASME Y14.5, the GD&T standard. So make sure that your drawings are neat and legible and they have a workmanlike quality. You should have already had two classes where we've dealt with this, Tech 1521, computer aided, or what is that, engineering graphics and descriptive geometry, and 4472, the computer aided design class. I cannot stress to you how important it is to be able to put together a good working drawing. That's what makes you employable. All right. We will look at some tooling drawings. This is a drawing from a progressive die, and I'll give you access to that drawing in the semester here sometime. All right, so in your tooling drawings, you know, above all, be clear, okay? So when the views get all crowded and you're using the wrong scale for the paper size and things like that, you know, you want it to not be crowded. You don't want it to be cluttered. You want to think about, as you're doing the design, how is the machinist going to make each of these cuts? Okay, how are they going to go in and make this part? Am I designing something that's easy to make, or am I designing something that's hard to make for no good reason? Here, just for fun, just because I have it up on my computer at the time, let's look at these little slots in this welding. This welding fixture. Okay, so if you're in Tech 1711 some years ago, you may have used this fixture to do a welding project. But this is where the weld goes, okay? And we have this hole back here, this slot, okay? I could have, when I was designing this thing, I could have designed that as a rectangular slot, okay? And if I had done that, it would have made this thing much more difficult to make, because rectangular, those sharp corners in here would have been hard to make. We would have had to use the EDM on them, or we would have had to use like a broaching operation or something. But all we need is a gap. All we need is a hole in there. Okay, we just need a space. That's just adding some insulation for the so that this doesn't act as a heat sink right up on our weld, so we get good penetration on the weld. But you know, there's a reason that it's nice and round like that. It's easy to make. In fact, this whole thing could be made, you know, this plate just in one setup. You set it up and you run the CNC program, goes in and makes the whole thing, okay? Design the parts as if you were going to make it and you were lazy, okay? So think about the cuts. Use standard values. Use the right product. We had a guy... not a major from our department, but a person came into the to the tech support shop and had a 3-inch diameter block of stainless or cylinder of stain or not stainless steel, it was aluminum, 3-inch diameter chunk of aluminum, 32 inches long, and said, you know, can you guys drill this out for me? I need this drilled out to 2 3/4 inch diameter. It's as if the guy had never heard of tube. Okay, so don't go out and make bonehead decisions and bonehead errors like that. Know what's available, okay? Know what's, you know, do some shopping and make sure that your design makes sense. You know, if it's going to be made out of a piece of sheet metal doesn't come in any thickness you want, okay? It comes in a few discrete gauge sizes. So know what thicknesses of sheet metal you can buy. Don't use, just remember, it's real easy to model giant chunks of material on a CAD system, but, you know, you got to pay for all of that. And if you're designing something where you have to remove 50% of the material when you could have just used a smaller piece of material, then that is not a cost-efficient, cost-effective design. All right, so also, you know, don't give more information than is necessary. Think about your tolerances. Now, with tool design, the tolerances are generally much tighter than in product design. But don't just go out and say everything is plus or minus one thou, okay? Use the tight tolerances where they make sense and where you can open up tolerances. For heaven's sakes, open them up. There are other things that are sort of just kind of logical. It's real easy to change the size of a shaft, okay? Holes, if they're going to be cheap, are made with standard drills and reamers, okay? Now, you can buy nicely sized shafts. You can get shafts in drill rod sizes that are standard diameters, but it's much easier to change the diameter of a shaft than that of a drilled hole. Now, if you have a large hole that's been bored out or something like that, then yeah, it makes sense. But think about that. In general, I'll say it's easier to change the size of a shaft than it is to change the size of a hole. Also, don't be an idiot, okay? I'm not going to call anybody out by name, but I had a person, this was a few years ago, working on a senior project who had drilled some holes in a block of metal and wanted to know what size tap you put in those holes. Okay, it doesn't work like that. And if you have cheated on quizzes and Googled your way into the senior level, and you don't know that you drill a particular sized hole for a particular tap, then I have very little hope for you. Okay, so when we say that these things in the lower grade and the lower levels are fundamental, it means that if you don't understand those things and from the processes one and processes two, you sound like a nitwit in tool design. Okay, so understand the background stuff. Go back and restudy things that you might have glossed over in your earlier education experience. Let's see here. Stock sizes, things like that. You may need to put notes on a print, but use those sparingly. Don't, just like with duplicate dimensions, you don't want to put information in a note that might be somewhere else. You can say, see some other document, whatever that document is, but don't repeat that information. All right, so tooling layout. You want to first, whenever you're doing tooling design, you always start with the product. Okay, so I'll just pop over here. I had that thing up. So here's that welding fixture. You see, I can turn on and off this the actual part by itself, and you know, you put these things on layers so that you can separate those out. You need to be able to easily distinguish where the part is and how your tooling interrelates with it. So if you're working in something like Unigraphics, then you'd pull this in as a whole assembly, and then you build off of it. Okay, so you will have a welding fixture design lab where I give you some components and you'll design the fixture. So the first step is make sure that your part exists in an assembly where you're going to develop your actual fixture. Also, I think it says it in the list there, but use standard parts. Don't waste time designing a toggle clamp. Go out and go to DeStaco or somebody and they will have models of the clamps and things. You just pull those in from the website. All right, so you lay out the part, you have it separate, some way to separate your part or the work part from the tooling that you're designing. You want to lay this thing out. Think about, you know, am I going to be able to get a welding gun in there? Indicate locating requirements. We'll talk about some of this later when we talk about work holding, but there's this 3-2-1 concept that we'll talk about later, so no need to, I'm not going to unpack that right now. Clamping requirements. Always do this full scale. I think that's abundantly clear in this day and age when you're using CAD for everything. Use standard fixture parts. Like I said, you know, go out and don't source these. Don't reinvent the wheel. And then obviously identify each item with balloons and liters. That would be on something like an assembly drawing. All right, so let's talk a little bit about tolerances, because in tool design, the tolerances get much smaller. And so this is actually probably a good time to talk about this. I try to talk about this in pretty much all of my classes, but being able to take apart these terms, tolerance, allowance, clearance, and interference. Okay, so first of all, when we're talking about the tolerance, we are talking about the limits of what is acceptable, what's going to be an acceptable part for our purposes, for the whatever the design intent is. So we'll have an upper specification limit and a lower specification limit, and our part has to fall within those limits. Okay, so if it falls without those limits, then it's not a good part for the purposes that we've established for it. All right, so that's tolerance. That sets up these goals. We have to have a tolerance, and I'm going to pop back to that other slide, because we can't make a part some exact amount, okay? This part in here is measuring something very, very close to 0.5 inches, but that's not exactly 0.5 inches, okay? It's getting very close, but we don't know what this next digit would be out here, okay? And we'll never know that. But what we can do is say that this is within some tolerance if we set the tolerances up to some whatever the value is. They could be very small. You know, we could have the difference between the upper specification limit and the lower specification limit can be diminishingly small. You know, it could be a millionth of an inch if we wanted to. It means our part's going to be extraordinarily expensive, but we can do that. But that's all we can do. We can never say it is some exact number. All right, think about, we could choose pi then. Have a cylinder with a radius or diameter of pi. You can't have that. And just in the same way, you can't have it be any other number, like 0.5 with an infinite number of zeros behind it. That doesn't make sense. But we can say it's between 0.5 and 0.5 plus a millionth of an inch. Clearance, on the other hand, is one type of allowance. Okay, so we'll just take these two and put them as a subcategory of allowance. Clearance, in this case, it's positive space. It is a gap in between the mating parts. So this is going to be a pin, and this is a hole that pin has to fit into. And what we do is we add a little gap around there. That is clearance. And clearance is one type of allowance. On the other hand, if we had a pin that was larger than the hole that it was supposed to go into, and we can do this by design, for example, if we wanted to have a press fit or a force fit or a shrink fit, then we can design the hole to be actually smaller than the shaft. And in that case, we have another type of allowance, which is interference. So it's good to be able to keep these in your mind and understand the difference. If you get on the internet, you'll hear them used interchangeably. And they're not. They're all distinct. They're all their own distinct concepts. All right, so I thought I'd talk a little bit about some of the types of tolerances that you get into in tool design. Now, this is, you know, obviously not a strict rule. You know, you may have welding fixtures and things that are going to have tolerances that are nowhere close to this. But, you know, we'll talk about gauge block tolerances, for example. So to kind of get your bearings here, this is a penny on edge, and underneath here I have inch units, and above these are metric units. Right now we're at mm. So we can zoom in a little bit, and by the time we're at sort of the thickness of a pencil lead, that is at the micrometer level. So that's about 0.5 millimeters, which is the same thing as 500 micrometers. So you might hear people talk about some number of microns when you start dealing with really tight tolerances, okay? So if we keep zooming in here a little bit, this is a Post-it notes thickness. That's about 0.004 of an inch, or about 100 microns, about 100 micrometers. So if we keep zooming in here a little bit, so that's 0.001, that's a thou. And, you know, in Tech 1711, that was kind of our de facto unit, about 0.001 of an inch. You know, you can hold that tolerance fairly well. In this class, if we're making parts in the lab, we do the engraver assignment. In semesters that we have that assignment, you'll be holding tolerances down here at this level, down here at a few 0.001 of an inch. Okay, so this would be what we call a half a thou, or 5/10,000 of an inch. All right, so there's a tenth, and we get in here. This is starting to get into the level of individual microns. All right, so this is a 0.010, which is about, you know, the same way that an inch is 25.4 millimeters. 1/10,000 of an inch is 2.54 micrometers, or microns. If we get in here a little bit further, now we're starting to get into the realm of nano. Okay, so this is 500 nanometers. This is a wavelength of red light, which is about 650 nanometers. You can also see this is a, I was going to try to find the COVID, the coronavirus molecule, but all I found was this is an old SARS virus. Sorry, not molecule. This is a SARS virus, and it's about 100 nanometers across. Okay, so this is down below where you can see things with light. You have to start using scanning electron microscopes, for example. It is at this level where we have gauge block tolerances. Okay, so notice if we drag our little virus down here, it's about the size of some of these gauge block tolerances, and these are grade 3 tolerances out here. That's some of the, you know, that's by no means the tightest tolerance. That's over here, a grade half. Okay, so we're talking about some pretty tight tolerances when we're talking about gauge blocks. And I will say, a lot of, you know, with tooling, the tooling has to be made much more precisely than the actual products do. So just for fun, I thought I'd zoom in a little bit more here. And this is getting to the level of angstroms and individual nanometers. All right, so there's 10 nanometers. Down here at the level of a single nanometer, we're starting to see atoms. So there's an iron atom, for instance, hydrogen atom. Let me just regenerate. All right, and that's really as far as I'm going to go in. Okay, so we're not too terribly far removed from that when we start getting into these gauge block tolerances. All right, so it's good to kind of get your bearings on these things and understand. One thing is, you know, if you think about a micro, seems like I have it on here somewhere. We'll get in here. There's a micrometer. Notice one thing, that a micrometer is actually much larger, a couple of orders of magnitude larger, whoops, I lost it, than a micro inch. Okay, just in the same way that a meter is much larger than an inch, a micrometer is much larger than a micro inch. And you'll see most of the places where you see micrometers and micro inches used are in surface roughness specifications. Well, I think I grabbed the wrong file. This one does not. Oh, yeah, there it is, right in front of me. All right, so there's the micro inch. Pretty dang small, getting down here to a few angstroms across for a micro inch, or a millionth of an inch. And there is a micrometer, And the comparison is the same between a meter and an inch. All right, so I just have fun doing that. All right, some other stuff that we're going to do this semester is take a look at the NX Progressive Die Wizard. This is just a video just kind of over looking at that, giving kind of the general overview of this. A super, super powerful tool. We are not going to use all the features on it. We're just going to use it to make a really simple die set. Some of you guys will probably wind up using it for your senior project, in which case you'll want to use a lot more of the functionality of it. But really just a super, super tool. Helps design die sets. And we'll use it to kind of get our bearings around a die set and to understand some of what goes into die set design. But like I said, we'll only be doing sort of the just a real simple project with it, but it is an extremely powerful tool that's out there. Another one that's that we'll look at is the NX Injection Mold Wizard. And again, we'll do just a simple project with it to kind of understand what goes into an injection mold, what goes into injection mold design, and to get sort of a look at the wizard as a tool. Last but not least, we will look a little bit at safety and understand that safety, whenever you're designing anything, should always be something that you are consciously being aware of. All right. So first of all, there are different ways that you can deal with these hazards. You know, you can warn people about them, you can guard against them, or you can design them out. Hopefully it's obvious that the real best thing to do is to design hazards out. So always the best case is to design the hazards out. Always break sharp edges. This should be a note on your prints. And in tool design, sometimes you have to be very specific about what sharp edges get broken, because again, if you're designing something like a cutting tool, you want sharp edges and you need to specify what edges and how those are to be handled. Make sure that the parts are rigid enough so that parts are not going to come loose. Foolproofing or poka-yoke is a very good thing to think about when you're designing tooling, especially things like jigs and fixtures. It's a good idea to do things like add a pin where a hole might match up if the part is inserted properly, but that pin may prevent an improperly inserted part from going actually into your fixture. So doing things like that, preventing a part from being made backwards or being welded backwards is a very good idea. If you can do that, build that in. That's kind of, you know, that's often, that's even free or very inexpensive to add some foolproofing, make parts so that, like on an injection mold, maybe take one corner of a mold insert, for example, and put a notch in it and put a notch in the corresponding cavity that it goes into, so that it can't be inserted backwards or upside down and make bad parts. Things like drill jigs that are going to be handled manually need to be large enough so that they don't spin inside the person's hand. That's maybe so much detail it belongs in the jig lecture. Use guards if possible. Like I said, if you can't design out the hazard, then use guards. Punch presses are their own sort of dangerous animal. Make sure that you understand about punch presses. We will talk about punch press safety separately. If you're designing something that has actuators or motion in them, build in limit switches that will prevent motion beyond what's desirable. Okay, and also maybe even design in things like shear pins so that if something is forced, it doesn't break the entire tool, it only breaks a shear pin, something like that, or doesn't damage a working mechanism, a machine or something. Use feed mechanisms to eliminate people handling parts, especially where that's dangerous. Electrical equipment has its own set of hazards. We should talk about that separately. Lockout tagout is a concept that you should be familiar with, and every company should have training for lockout tagout, and they should have a system in place for their lockout and tagout procedures, and then other safety provisions as necessary. All right, so that's the introduction, and we'll see you next time.